You know, markets are generally efficient where they're processing information, new information quite quickly, but there's still a baseline of market participants that are humans, and we are, by definition, emotional creatures.
All right, Stephen Tuckwood, a.k.a. Tuck. How you doing, buddy?
I'm doing well. Thanks, Dean.
Thanks for joining Bud and I here on America's Wealth Management Show. And we're going to talk about market corrections. And, you know, we had a sell-off in April here of 2024. And then on August 5th, we saw a pretty big drawdown. In fact, we saw the NASDAQ go into correction territory. And S&P 500 was very, very close to it. If it didn't leak over into it, maybe in a midday drawdown. Since then, we've had some rebounds. These bouts of market volatility drive people crazy because they don't understand why the markets are doing what they are doing. And, you know, you listen to some people talk and they say, well, markets are efficient, so just ignore it and let it go. But sometimes it doesn't feel efficient, and that emotion of fear and that emotion of greed can leak in. So, Tuck, as a chartered financial analyst, talk to us about why you believe that market corrections are healthy. But before you do that, explain what a market correction is. What's the definition?
Yeah, thanks, Dean. Yeah, there's no real universally accepted definition, but most people think of it as a 10% pullback from a recent high to a recent low, followed by gains back up. And that really distinguishes a correction from a bear market. And a bear market might be defined as a decline of 20% and often lasts longer. So corrections actually happen quite frequently in the equity market. They're just a reset of prices a little bit lower, and then oftentimes a base to build up from to have future gains. So happen a lot. They're healthy to the extent that they help to refresh prices. So it gives people, it shakes out some weaker hands at market highs and allows people to enter the market at a lower level. And it really stops these parabolic moves higher that are unhealthy, where everybody's chasing, and then there's a big crash. When there are corrections, and these, like I say, these do happen quite frequently, it's often a healthy, functioning market that we see these in.
You know,
go ahead, bud.
You know, Dean, if you take it another way, it's a gut check. You know, you're asking yourselves, the way I had my money invested and now I've had a decline, is that acceptable to what my future needs are going to be and our expectations that markets will regain an upward bias? So a gut check, I think, applies to most of my clients anyway.
Yeah, I would agree with that. And Tuck, here's, you know, everybody that is in the investment world has heard of the Oracle of Omaha, Warren Buffett. And if they haven't caught up with this, Warren Buffett is now holding the largest cash position that he has ever held. And one of Warren Buffett's saying is, you want to be fearful when others are greedy and greedy when others are fearful. And right now we look at Warren Buffett with this huge cash position, and we look at the individual investment, the individual investor having today the largest equity exposure that we've seen in a really, really long time. So are we in a scenario where people are being greedy and so Buffett's being fearful? You know, is this market volatility and the correction that we saw, this recent correction, is that news for a further pullback in the market? And that's what Buffett's waiting on, is a further pullback so that he can get greedy when everybody else is fearful. I think there's something to think about there, and I'd like to get your thoughts on that, Tuck.
Yeah, it's hard to say. You know, he's obviously running a very large portfolio, a very large business, and there can be a whole series of factors going into his decision-making. So it might not be that he's interpreting that as, oh, you know, markets are overvalued, let me raise cash for lower prices. It could well be that, but I just don't know the details of why his actions have been the way they are. But generally, yeah, there's an element of fear and greed to the stock market. That's why it does oscillate up and down, and there's periods where behavior is irrational, and that's because human beings are involved, and we're emotional creatures, and we do react to things and typically move in herds as well. So There's definitely a herding element to it. So, you know, markets are generally efficient where they're processing information, new information quite quickly, but there's still a baseline of market participants that are us humans, and we are by definition emotional creatures.
Yes. So, Tuck, when you realize that you're in a situation where the market is starting to fall down, what should people be telling themselves in terms of what the future may lie, or should they play it more safe? Should we adjust portfolios to a lower level of risk at a time when the market is actually getting a lower, therefore more attractive?
Yeah, I think the main point here is that a investor's portfolio, an amount of risk, should reflect what it needs to be for that individual. And the way that you find out what that is going through a financial planning process and having a portfolio built to power that plan forward. So there's, you know, a well-built portfolio is going to be diversified. There are going to be different sections or pockets of money that are invested in a certain way, long-term, short-term, and then your more immediate liquidity needs as well. So equity investing should by nature be a long-term exercise. It's a volatile asset class. We saw that, you know, on August 5th with a market decline, and that should be expected. So when we're allocating to that, when we're investing money in the stock market, we should be thinking with a long-term mindset for that section of the portfolio. And we can do other things with other parts of the portfolio that are shorter term.
So we talk about having a short-term bucket of money, which is, if you're still working, maybe that's your emergency funds or things that you're going to purchase in the next 2 to 3 years, that money should be in something that's very, very safe. And then you got your intermediate term, something where you may be thinking, I'm going to buy a vacation home, or I'm going to buy my first home, and I got to save some money for that. And that's a, you know, 5 to 7 year type of a time frame. And then your longer term is, you know, call it 8 years plus before you're ever going to touch that money. And you need to really look at each one of those buckets individually and say, what should the allocation be in each one of those buckets, as opposed to just saying, you know, a blanket allocation of a 60-40 portfolio, for an example.
Yeah, exactly. It needs to be tailored to a specific person's needs and what their life is going to be and how that's going to unfold. We're in a good spot right now in that short-term bucket is actually rewarding investors. You know, we can get over 5% in a more of a risk-free security over the short term. That might change if the Federal Reserve does lower rates, but at least for now, in this moment, we can get attractive returns to be in that in those positions where that's not always been the case in the recent past. But yeah, then as you get further out and the time horizon lengthens for that portion of the portfolio, that's when you can take more risk in that you're allocating to riskier assets because you have time on your side. And, you know, market corrections, they happen all the time, but they can be dangerous if we have a downturn, you sell, you turn that loss into a permanent loss of capital by realizing the loss, only to then miss out on further gains. So that's, you know, really got to stay the course with riskier assets. And that's where putting them in the right place in the portfolio is important.
So if we assume, Tuck, that in the fall when the Federal Reserve next meets and they go in and they lower the rate, and most people that view our show or listen to our show understand that we've been in an inverted yield curve. In simple definition, means you're getting paid more in the shorter maturities of treasuries or CDs for that matter than in the longer ones. And I'm curious as to what your thought might be in terms of what that might, how that might impact those interest rate scenarios if the Federal Reserve starts to lower rates again.
Yeah, great point, Bud. And yeah, the yield curve is still inverted. We still have the federal fund rate above 5%. And we have a Federal Reserve meeting coming up in September, and then two additional ones after that for this year in November and December. So three potential places for the Fed to cut at those meetings. And September's meeting, you know, the market is pretty much predicting that there's going to be a cut. 25 basis points is the baseline expectation. I think this recent bout of volatility that we saw in the markets on August 5th has probably increase the likelihood of that being the case. So we know that we've seen the kind of economy weaken a little bit, and the Fed opened the door with some of its language on its last meeting to start making cuts. So yeah, we should likely expect that the Fed is going to begin embarking on a rate cutting cycle now, after having gone through the rate hiking and then stabilization. So what that means for investors is some of these higher rates that we've enjoyed in essentially risk-free assets, very short-term instruments, they will likely be lower, if not significantly lower, 6 to 12 months from now. So, you know, we have to...
Tuck, that also represents an opportunity that we've been talking about here over the last few months, and that is the opportunity to go out a little longer on the yield curve and lock in a better rate, you know, say it's a 5-year or a 7-year or even a 10-year. And if the thought process is that the Fed's going to start cutting rates, you've locked that rate in, that 7 to 10 year rate. And if the rates do go down, then you should get some price appreciation on the longer maturities of treasuries or even corporate or municipal bonds. So, you know, you could pick up, you know, some more typical type fixed income returns in the, you know, 6 to 7% range over time, as opposed to sitting in that money market and watching that interest rate continue to decline. What are your thoughts there on beginning to get out a little further on a yield curve?
Yeah, I think that'd, you know, be a positive move. And what I have to take into consideration is that the markets are somewhat efficient as well. So the reason that the curve is inverted, one of the reasons is that the longer end of the curve is pricing in and predicting the lowering of the short-term rates. So that's kind of the discounting mechanism that's happening across the interest rate curve, particularly in the treasury curve. So yeah, I think it's a spot to be, you know, tactically adding at the margin on the longer side. Another way of saying that is to add duration, interest rate risk to the portfolio by going out a little bit longer. Because yeah, as we're trying to anticipate what the Fed will do, you know, once they start cutting rates, historically they have cut in a series of them, as opposed to just one cut and stop, tends to be followed by more cuts. So with that in mind, you know, we anticipate the short-term rate being, you know, considerably lower 6 months from now.
Tuck, let's talk a little bit about the length of time that it takes for either a rate hike or a rate cut to actually get its way into the overall economy so that the economy begins to feel the effects of that rate hike or that rate cut. I've heard, you know, 9 months is kind of a time frame that it takes really to, you know, for that rate cut or that rate hike to get its way into the economy. So it's going to be tough for the Federal Reserve to say, I'm going to cut here, I'm going to cut here, I'm going to cut here. Oh, I still don't want to have what I want. I'm going to cut again. And they may overcut and, you know, cause inflation to come back. And at the same time, they could not cut enough and then cause a recession. So what's that time frame and how does the Fed juggle that? How does Jerome Powell pull off his Sully Sullenberger imitation and achieve a soft landing?
Yes, yeah, it's difficult. It's difficult to balance the two things, the fight against inflation, you know, price stability, in other words, and peak employment, which is a representation of a healthy economy. How do you keep that balance? And yeah, it's an imperfect tool that they have. Like you say, there is a delay to it. So it's like turning the thermostat and then, you know, you don't know what the temperature is, you know, 45 minutes from now, and then you end up going back and having to tweak it back down. So it's, you know, it's an imperfect tool, but it's the one that they have. I think this particular Fed and this Fed governor have learned a lot from this last cycle. You know, they're obviously behind the ball for hiking the rates when they thought that inflation was more transitory. So I think that's really within their psyche. So this cutting cycle looks to be really at the front edge here, in that the economy is softening. Yes, we'd agree with that, but it's not troublingly so. You know, it's not falling off a cliff. So for them to be embarking on this rate cutting cycle now feels like they're being pretty proactive, which has not always been the case.
I think it would be remiss on our part if we didn't ask you the question that, based upon what we're seeing in the global conflicts that are occurring around the world right now, and of course the election coming up, can you share with our viewers and our listeners what impact that could have from a historical perspective of similar, but not exactly, the same situation we're having today?
Yeah, there's always something going on in the world. That's for a fact, and that's why this industry is so interesting. I think is there's always new things to think about, and exogenous shocks that can come, and unforeseen events that we all just have to deal with. In terms of the Middle East, if there is more of a widespread unrest there, that could certainly have big issues, particularly for the energy market, and other places around the world too. It's hard to know. Anything can happen at any time. You just have to think back to Russia invading Ukraine. They were building up forces right there on the border. Most people thought they wouldn't ultimately invade, and they ended up doing that. So really hard to predict what might happen from a geopolitical standpoint. And yeah, obviously we have a very big election here coming up in November.
Let's go back to the correction here for a minute. And I think when we get this correction, and we know that they're frequent, on average, it's about once a year. Some years you don't get one, some years you get two. But we know that those corrections are frequent. We know that those corrections are healthy. They're a reset. The question is, how often do those corrections actually turn into a prolonged bear market, and what do people look for to say, okay, this is just a normal correction, or this is the beginning of a real bear market?
Yeah, it's really difficult to say. It's really just hindsight that you can clearly state, oh, this correction turned into a bear market. Bear markets are a lot rarer, thankfully. It's not that volatile of an asset class. So, it's like picking the direction of the stock market over any shorter period of time is really, really difficult. So what we can do is just continue to monitor the things that we deem as important or that are drivers to the equity market. And those things are typically changes in liquidity and changes in corporate profit growth.
What assets, Tuck, would you say that people should be in? Let me even get more specific. The retirees should look at, if in fact they're worried about what the election and the global events are.
Yeah, if there's a certain event that's coming up that you might view as a potentially volatile moment for riskier assets, then it's okay to just dial back risk in various ways and just sit on the sidelines to some extent. I'm not talking about moving to all cash or anything like that. I'm just talking about making changes at the periphery of the portfolio. If you're a little uncomfortable with how things are shaking out in whatever scenario, and you'd like to just dial things back a little bit, I mean, that's absolutely fine too. But the importance is staying the course for the longer term assets in your portfolio, because those are the growth drivers. And you really don't want to be missing out on, the future growth that will ultimately come. I mean, the stock market over the long term, you just have to look at the chart. It's lower left to upper right. But that's measured in decades and not years or months.
Well, and Bud, if you're following the whole idea that you have a short, an intermediate, and a long-term bucket, and let's say that somebody's in retirement, that longer-term bucket, you may have a double-digit return one year, and you may say, "Hey, I want to take some of those winnings, and I'm gonna refill that short-term bucket." And you have enough winnings there. You've maybe filled up that short-term bucket where it's overfull. You have a correction. Well, now you can take some out of that short-term bucket and put it back into the long-term bucket at a lower price. So, I think that's what you're talking about, Tuck. It's tactical asset allocation changes that are not necessarily wholesale, but proactively rebalancing and doing the right things over time, even though it seems to be counterintuitive to people to say, well, if my stock portfolio that was 60-40 is now 70-30, why would I take that 10% that I've made, you know, in the stock and put it back over into fixed income? Because
but take a measured approach, which is what you're exactly advocating.
Right. Exactly right. So I think the stats, Tuck, show us that about 1 in 5 corrections will actually become a bear market. And some bear markets are very short-lived. For an example, the bear market that occurred Black Monday, 1987, that was a really short bear market and rebounded. It was almost like a V-shaped recovery, just boom, right back up. But of course, we all know now that there were some trading activities and the electronic trading systems that really triggered that sell-off. But at any rate, we're down to about a minute and a half, Tuck. What else do investors, people need to be thinking of? And how important is working with a certified financial planner and building out that plan so that you actually know what your allocation needs to be?
Yeah, I think that's the key. It's, you know, everybody knows kind of the old analogies. So let's stick to the plan. You know, in times of distress, when things are going wrong, it's, you know, where's the North Star? Well, let's get back on track and stick to the plan. If there is no plan, then you're not making decisions in a vacuum. You become very reactionary and your behavioral impulses really take over that decision-making process. So to me, that's the real importance of a financial plan, is a thoughtful portfolio construction that comes with that powers that plan. And that's really the gauge of success then. It's am I on track for my own goals, for my plan? And if that gets thrown off by moves in the market, then we can make adjustments. But without that North Star, you know, it's really hard to say what are we actually aiming at.
Yeah, I appreciate it. All right, ladies and gentlemen, you've been listening to America's Wealth Management Show. I'm Dean Barb, along with Bud Casper, our special guest, Stephen Tuckwood, chartered financial analyst and director of investments here at Modern Wealth Management. We appreciate everybody joining us. Until next time, everybody stay healthy and stay safe.
Represent the opinion of Modern Wealth Management, LLC, an SEC-registered investment advisor. Information provided is for illustrative purposes only and does not constitute investment, tax, or legal advice. Modern Wealth Management does not accept any liability for the use of the information discussed. Consult with a qualified financial, legal, or tax professional prior to taking any action.